Hello. In this presentation, we'll solve the problem of congestion avoidance for a very particular kind of traffic scenario called as the city traffic scenario. Now, fundamentally, there are two types of congestions. One are called as the recurrent congestions, which means that this road is always under congestion at say 3 p.m. So it's well known to all the people who use that road that the road always gets congested, and if there was an alternative route possible, the people would have already experimented with that. They would have considered that if it's possible to leave at a different time, people would have already experimented with that. They would have already done that. Or if there is, say, no other option possible, you have already accounted for the fact that this road will be under congestion and you've taken in enough time well in advance. The other are what is known as non-recurrent congestions. Now, these are the kind of congestions which just happen. There is no magic formula to derive when they would happen. They just happen. So, one fine morning, you were traveling on a road and suddenly you saw that there is congestion ahead and there is nothing you can do. You might not have even kept enough slack time in your journey. So, these kind of congestion, they really bother in people because they did not account for them at any time in planning their route or at any time in planning their journey, and they've just happened. And these are the congestions that are possible for all the delay that we have, for all the inefficiency that we have. Now, we would be solving this problem of non-recurrent traffic or non-recurrent congestion where the traffic trends do not follow historical patterns for a very specific kind of scenario which is derived from cities. So we'll see into what this kind of traffic scenario is, and particular for this type of scenario we'll solve the problem of congestion avoidance. And as is a central theme in all our works, the notion of diversity would be taken. So the traffic scenario that I have, operating in a city kind of traffic infrastructure, the vehicles will have very large diversity. So there will be some vehicles which are very fast, there will be some vehicles which are very slow, there will be some vehicles which are painfully slow. And we'll see that how this affects the transportation architecture or the transportation framework. Now, as I said that we'll be looking in for a special kind of scenario or a city traffic scenario. Now, in general, the problem of routing, which says there is a road network graph, which may be anything like this. It'll of course be much neater than this. Now, in general, it's a simple graph and any kind of graph search algorithm works. Now, in order to solve this problem, from now on, what we would be doing, we'll say that it's not just any kind of graph, but rather we'll look at some of the characteristics of this graph. So when we delve deeper into what kind of graph this is, what are the general properties of this graph, we see that there are two very distinctive kind of scenarios that arise. One is what is called as a highway traffic scenario and the other is called as a city traffic scenario. The highway kind of traffic scenario is, say there is a city, there is a highway that goes from one city, it connects the suburbs of that city, meanwhile it joins another highway and somewhere ahead it joins another highway which lead to different city, to different suburbs or to different cities. They might even be two highways leading differently to the same suburb or to the same city. So we've got some extra long roads. So these are all highways, these are all motorways. So they are extra long. They are very long in length. And there are very few of them. In fact, this might be an area worth a large number of square miles that is covered by a very few number of highways. In cities, we've got a different kind of scenario. We see small roads, so right outside your home, there might be a road like this, which might be connecting to some other road, which might be connecting to some other road, which might be connecting to a main road like this, the main road of the city, and then many different roads might form a framework outside such a road. There might be another main road like this, and another main road that's connected out like this. And then again, small road frameworks out here that you see all around. So it's a very densely packed, it's a very densely connected, it's a very redundantly connected kind of architecture. There are many small and big roads out here. So whenever I need to go from one place to the other, here I've got so many options. I may take this route, I may take this route, I may take this route. I may take more main roads, I may take more of the side roads, but here there are very limited options in how may I, like here we've got one option, we may go here or we may go like this, but there are in short very few roads and very few options in a highway kind of traffic scenario. Now, given this kind of characteristic nature of my road network graph, I instantly come up with a property. And that property is that when I am operating in a city kind of scenario, or when I am operating in such kind of scenario, what may happen is that I start my journey out here. I say that let me travel through this route. Let me travel through this route that's drawn out over here, where there might be some network connecting this route to the other network like this. Now, I've committed to this route, and what appears to be a good route, what might happen that suddenly there are a few families here, there are a few families here, and there are too few families here. While I have reached this point, all these families decided to take a weekend altogether, and now this road gets very congested. While this route is not very congested. So, in a city kind of scenario, at any time, from anywhere, right from the route that you have selected, suddenly there might be people who have appeared out of nowhere. There might be homes nearby, or there might be some other people who have traveled in, and now they are to be found in this route. So suddenly they might new people might appear out in this route, making this a less of a good choice. So that's something that's very common in a road, in a city traffic. Whereas if I know that I am here, there are certainly no homes in motorways, or there are very few more homes in motorways. The cities are distantly located, so I won't have a sudden gush of people out this highway. So once I'm standing at this location and I see this highway seems to be good, it seems to be better than this highway, it's worthwhile using this highway. I cannot expect a sudden gush at this highway. And of course, once I am committed to this highway, there's nothing else that I can do. I'll have to follow this right till the end. So that is what is in a highway kind of scenario, where the roads are very less, where they are not dense route. And because of this, what happens that I cannot forward plan too much when it comes to a city traffic scenario. Like I, as I said over here, I forward plan much. I decided this route, and suddenly new families have decided to have weekends, and they have spoiled my plan. Now this plan is very bad, which was earlier appearing to be very good. So because of this uncertainty of people suddenly jumping out from nowhere, my anticipation abilities are low. And because my anticipation ability are low, my long-term plans can never be ascertained. Anytime somebody will come, I'll have to do something else. Whereas here, anticipation is large. I can always anticipate what will be the traffic here, and that will be quite reliable. And because of that, I can commit to some long-term plans. Now, the planning for such kind of problem as we know, where you are one vehicle out of a pool of some other vehicles out here, and all of you, them are trying to find the best route from their respective source to their respective goals. Now, in such a kind of scenario where there are too many vehicles, the first option is always to consider a centralized system where all the vehicles are planned as a single chunk, considering all possible combination of movements or all possible combination of routes for each of these vehicles, which is certainly not possible. The number of vehicles may be too high, they may be computationally expensive, as well as all the vehicles need to be planned using the same system, so there's no scope for human-driven vehicles out here. So a more practical point of view is the decentralized system, where I plan each and every vehicle separately. And the major question lies that when I'm planning each and every vehicle separately, that what do I do with the other vehicles? I may select this route, and too many and other vehicles may also select the same route, making it congestion prone. So the first is that I simply say that I do not care about the other vehicles. I'll simply for assume that there are no other vehicles. And clearly, this is a bad kind of thing to do, because there might be a main road and there might be some small interconnecting road like this. It might look that from traveling from here to traveling from here, if I can quickly come to the main road, use this main road and then travel here, it might look to be a good option. But then what if 1,000 vehicles plan to do the same thing? This main road will get extremely congested. It will get extremely congested. Then it might have been better to use such kind of interconnected roads. Come here and only cross the main road and not flow with it. It might have been a better possibility. So once you do not consider any other vehicles, you do not account for the fact that this main road might be too congestion prone by the other vehicles, which is a limitation of such kind of scenario. The other option is that, again, I take the same scenario where there is a main road, there is some road network like this out here. Now, here what I say is that I use historical information, I use the historical facts to find out whether this road is normally congested at that point of time, or is it usually free to go. If that road is usually congested at that point of time, I will take in this route. And if it's not usually congested, I will take in this route. And historical data will give me enough of indication whether it's profitable to take that route or not. Well, this is certainly a better system. But of course, our assumption is that the recurrent trends of traffic will be repeated, while our model is for non-recurrent traffic where the historic trends are not repeated. And in this particular example, to be more clear, that if out of nowhere a traffic congestion comes in at this road, which never happened in the past, or a non-recurrent congestion happens in this road, then we are stuck. We committed to this route, we entered this nice highway out over here, or this nice main road out here, and later out of nowhere congestion happened. Now we are stuck. So this is the limitation of the system. The other concept that I can do is that, again, in the same scenario where there is a main road, I say I do not use the historical information, but I know where the other vehicles are, and say I know where they want to go and by what route they want to go. I can use a traffic simulation system that will tell me if I use this road whether a congestion will happen or not. If it will happen, then by what magnitude, and if I use this road instead, whether I'll get a better bargain, or this one would be a better bargain. So basically, I'm simulating all these vehicles together using all the possible routes. And while doing so, I should know how each one of these other vehicles in the system, they travel. So of course, an assumption is that all the other vehicles are intelligent. If I select this route and suddenly out of nowhere, new families out in this area decide to travel and use the same route, that is a limitation to my problem. So new vehicles coming in later into the system, they invalidate the path. As well as if there are too many of these vehicles, I have to do micro simulations using all these vehicles, which is again time costly. Each one of my vehicle I'll need to simulate, so it's more towards the it's a decentralized system, but it's more on towards the centralized side. So it's a very large time complex system. And the other limitation that we have is that whenever I'm dealing with very diverse kinds of scenario where there are some very diverse concepts like overtaking and traffic signals associated, if I decide that if by traffic simulation it appears that my vehicle will, if it appears that my vehicle will reach a traffic light here and the traffic light would be green and it'll travel, and in reality what happens that my traffic lights, my vehicle comes and immediately the light changes red, now there's a big lag. And for a diverse scenario with diverse vehicle, this lag can make in a lot of difference towards the overall optimality of the route. So along with time, the uncertainties by which we have used micro simulations, they grow. And in such uncertain environment, no accurate or no reliable decision can be made. So the simulations are uncertain and they pick up a limitation of this group of approach. Now, we'll not be solving all these problems using a very hefty, complex or kind of difficult manner. We'll be using them, using that in a very easy kind of manner. The reason for the previous slide was to make sense of this very short line, which will be the central mantra behind this entire work. It's the central key idea, it's the concept behind this work. And that simply says that in a city kind of environment, I'm not talking about highway environment, in a city kind of environment, we have to plan very frequently. Because the environment is changing dynamically, because congestion is changing, because more and more vehicles enter, because many vehicles leave. So a lot of things are dynamically happening. So we cannot say that we will decide a route from source to goal and then we will follow it. Instead, what we need to do is that this route we will modify as we go. So suppose if we reached this point here, we may go for this route, or here we may again opt for this route. We'll continuously refine our plans, we'll very frequently replan. And as we know that if we replan too much, if we replan continuously, a city scenario is a very dense scenario, there are too many roads associated, and hence planning can get very time costly. If done again and again over time, it can get more costly. So we'll only make short-term plans, we'll make no long-term plans. So if this is the source, this is the goal, we'll only make some short plan over here and we'll think of how to navigate it. While we reach here, we'll think of how to reach more closer to the goal. And because we knew from the previous slide that long-term goals are unreliable, there's no point in making this route when we know that the metrics based on which this route has the later part of this route has been calculated, it'll change with time. So this in short will be the basic idea behind how to solve this problem, or how to solve the problem of congestion avoidance in city traffic for a non-recurrent kind of congestion. Now if whenever we need to solve a transportation problem, there are a few basics that I need to list out, and they are the basic of traffic simulation. How a vehicle is driving, basically, when now one vehicle, whenever it needs to drive another vehicle, so how this vehicle is driving behind this, or this vehicle behind this thing. It's a standard model called as the intelligent driver model, which basically converts this separation into travel speeds, and there's an input of VPREF. And in our scenario, this VPREF are very diverse, so very different kinds of speeds. Some are very high, some are very low. So it's a standard model that we are using, which enables one vehicle to follow another vehicle. And of course, in a transportation scenario, something more happens. A vehicle can change lane like this, or it can stay at the same lane. So the metric used is the It's called as a time to collision vehicle. So if this vehicle was very fast and it had a slow moving vehicle ahead, it had some slow moving vehicle here and it had some slow moving vehicle here. If these three are by the are traveling at the same speeds, then obviously changing lane here would be beneficial because I get this more extra distance to travel at higher speeds. If this vehicle is traveling at a higher speed, it's preferable to travel here because I can travel at higher speed. If this vehicle has a higher driving speed than this vehicle, then basically I'm whatever I can simply drive in. This vehicle does not affect me. I can simply drive in this road. So summarizing everything, if my time to collision, I'll choose the lane with the highest time to collision. That's the metric which combines the distance, as in here, and the speed, as in here, into a single metric, and I'll always choose the lane with the maximum time to collision. Now, a problem that happens with this in a multi-vehicle scenario or in a scenario where the vehicles have very diverse speeds. There might be a fast-moving vehicle out here. There might be a slow-moving vehicle out here. Now, if a vehicle comes here, which is much faster than both these vehicles, it's kind of trapped. So instead, we follow an overtaking lane-based scenario where if the traffic is sparse, the traffic is not too much, a vehicle will always travel at the leftmost lane. So it'll travel at the leftmost lane, and when I say it'll travel at the leftmost lane, it's only if it's traveling close towards the maximum speed, which again characterizes that the traffic is sparse. And why do I do that? Suppose in this scenario, this vehicle was traveling at 10 miles per hour, this was traveling at 20 miles per hour. This can see that time to collision is not infinity, it's positive. It can change lane, it can come ahead. When it's traveling with speed 20 ahead, in this kind of scenario, it's traveling with speed 20 ahead. Now, what happens? There might be a vehicle with 30 miles per hour which wants to overtake this vehicle out here. So it nicely dips into the leftmost lane so that this vehicle with speed 30 miles per hour can come here. It can first overtake this vehicle with 10 miles per hour, then it can overtake this vehicle with 20 miles per hour, and then again it can dip left if there's a 40 miles per hour vehicle behind. So it enables easier overtaking, such overtaking kind of lane change mechanism where a vehicle, if traveling with its close to maximum speed, which would only be possible in a sparsely followed, in a sparsely occupied traffic scenario, it prefers to stay at the leftmost lane to allow its easier overtaking by the other vehicles. And now, one of the problems that we've got is that any city, it basically has a road like this, where this is meant for traffic from this side, this road is meant for traffic from this side. So if there is a bicycle here traveling very slow and you are a car here, legal, technically there is nothing you can do but to follow the bicycle, which will be, it can be a very long road, and you basically have to can do nothing except for following such kind of scenario. In practice, what we normally see is that this vehicle sees whether there is any other vehicle coming up from here. If no, it can overtake like this. It goes to the wrong side, completes the overtake and returns to the right side. And remember, this is a bicycle traveling terribly slow, and this is a car traveling which is capable of driving quite fast. And as a result of this overtake, the efficiency of this vehicle will be boosted. So that's what's called as a single lane overtake. This is again something that will only happen in a sparsely occupied road. In a densely occupied road, the vehicles are clearly following each other at very low speeds. So that's not much of interest. That is a congestion scenario. After congestion happens, there's nothing that you can do about it. So how do we enable single lane overtakes to happen? The vehicle which needs to perform the single lane overtake. So I've got A as the faster vehicle here, which is the vehicle behind. It checks this separation. If more, then it extrapolates this trajectory, it extrapolates its position out here. Now, A was a faster moving vehicle, so it extrapolates that if I accelerate and if I reach here, what time will I be ahead of the vehicle B here, which is the vehicle to be overtaken. So in the time A has reached from here to here, B has reached from here to here, and any other oncoming vehicle C has reached from here to here, and as it is apparent that A was the fastest moving vehicle followed by C and then B. So these are the projected motions. The new traffic scenario, which is only in A's head, is B here, A here, overtaken completed, and C here. It checks both these separations, and after which it can return to its original lane. And again, this is only at A's head that such a kind of scenario happens. If these separations that it checked, they happen to be larger than threshold, then overtake, single lane overtake will be attempted. The vehicle A will move towards the wrong side. It will use the intelligent driver model to comfortably place itself ahead of B, and henceforth to return back. Now, C may in fact travel differently than what is visible out here. C may have accelerated initially, making the plan infeasible, but later it will have to cooperate so that A can complete the overtake. C will basically have to cooperate. It will have to slow down in order to make A complete the overtake. So even though the initial plan is made so that C is completely unaffected, C does not have to do anything. It can just drive normally at the same speed. If any time during the single lane overtake C happened to accelerate so that the plan gets later infeasible, C will at the later stage have to decelerate to make the plan feasible. And that's all, these are something that will happen naturally as per the intelligent driver model. And with that, I have a simulation framework. All I need to do is a routing algorithm which enables me to decide how to go from a source to a goal using some road framework like this. And that's what's my basic mantra. That's the only thing that I have which enables me to compute the route. This is the only idea that is floated out in this presentation. I need to make frequent, effective, short-term plans. Now, there are three keywords out here: frequent, effective, and short-term. I'll be taking them one by one. Now, as I said, that my route is based on some dynamic information. It's based on some traffic information which is dynamically changing. So if I select this kind of route which is shown here at start, this route may not be perfect, it may not be best at a later stage of time. So when I come here, this route may prove to be suboptimal and some other route may prove to be optimal. So I have to replan continuously. Now in a road scenario, what happens is that suppose I started from source, this was road 1, this was road 2, and all the way up to goal. If I start here and I am at this position and I find that I'm able to find a better route from the source, say this route was better. Now I cannot move back, I cannot move back from the source. This U-turn is not allowed, or this moving back is not allowed. So I will have to wait till here before changing any route. Before changing any route, I am committed to this route, I'll have to travel at least till here. So the maximum planning frequency, or the maximum that you can replan, which is my key idea over here, the maximum planning corresponds to replanning at every crossing or at every intersection, and that's what has been implemented. When I say effective, I mean it's basically a graph search. A road network will always be a graph and the search will always be a graph search. So by effective, I mean only the cost function, and here the cost function, it tries to do three things. Firstly, it's trying to minimize the travel time that it takes to travel from the source to the goal, or the shortest and the most fastest routes will be selected, which is what we consider, consult in the static traffic sense. In fact, that's the only thing that we consider in static traffic planning or in static route planning. The second thing, of course, is that the traffic density or the traffic congestion or the number of vehicles that I expect at that time or at that route should be as less as possible, or my expected traffic density should be as minimum as possible. And the third is here, here and here, there would be something known as traffic lights. Now traffic lights play a very important role, and sometimes we do not consider them at all at route planning. Many times what happens, for 2 to 3 minutes you need to really do nothing but wait at the traffic light, and as a result all your planning gets changed. So here we have explicitly considered that I will add all the expected time at each and every crossing. So suppose this crossing has an expected travel time of 30 seconds. On an average, every vehicle waits for 30 seconds at this crossing. I will add this factor up. So when we use this cost function, the effective cost function will be a function of all these three. This is what is a cost function. When I supply this cost function to any graph search algorithm, it will give me the best path, or it will give me the most effective route. And number three was, the word here was short term. Now what do I mean by short term is that the map, the city map, we have assumed it's too complex. We cannot plan from the source to the goal. There are too many routes, there are too many competing routes to be considered, there are too many roads out here. It's a very dense graph and we cannot plan from the source to the goal in a short time. More so, if we have to replan at every crossing, we can definitely not do. Now, initially what we tried to simulate was without this phenomena, we said every vehicle replans at every crossing. And every vehicle makes a full plan as per this cost function. And obviously we learned that it cannot be simulated at all. Every vehicle takes in a few seconds of planning time multiplied by the thousands of vehicles, and I need to replan at every crossing, so multiplied by the number of crossing, it becomes a huge time. So that's not possible. So we take in a nice little heuristic which human drivers, they tend to take a lot. Human drivers will, basically if you ask a human driver, that he consult all possible routes in order to reach the destination, and he'll probably tell you no. He'll tell you that this is the kind of map that we are in. In this city we are here, we need to go here. So I take this route, it gets me here. I then take this route, it gets me here. And from here there I will get a direct route to the goal. So how they are planning is that they are always trying to make them move towards the goal. They are not planning the entire route, they are trying to go towards the goal. And we know that in a city kind of infrastructure, where there are too many roads which are all interconnected to each other in a very dense way, if we travel towards the goal, the probability that we reach the goal by some or the other route is very high. In fact, that's what we later on did. We use this heuristic that traveling towards the goal always reaches us to the goal. So in a city map like this, we started at the source, we traveled towards the goal, and we said that can we reach the goal without turning back, and the answer was always yes. There always happened to be some or the other route that we could take without having to turn back. So that's something very nice about the city traffic, that as long as you travel towards the goal, you will never reach a dead end, you will never reach a point from where you have to travel back and then take the actual route to the goal. That is what the human drivers tend to take a lot. And that is what we would be doing in this search algorithm. We would be traveling towards the goal. So there are problem 2, which means effective, and there's problem 3, which means short term. I've highlighted problem 2 nicely by, this is the problem 2. I have highlighted it as a graphical this thing. This means a very high traffic density, and this means a very low traffic density. So the width denotes density. Now we've got clearly 3 routes over here. This is route 1. It's clearly long. The length is large. The traffic density here, it's large. Here it's large. So I mean, it's kind of moderate traffic density. But the number of traffic lights are large. So there'll be a route here, there'll be a route here. And I've got a high number of traffic lights. So because the traffic density is moderate, it may be expected that I can reach the destination by moderate speeds. It won't be very fast, but I can use moderate speed. But it's long, so it'll take longer, and there are large number of traffic lights. This is very congested, and because it's very congested, route 2, it is very short of course, but it's very congested and it has less traffic lights. So there's some kind of congestion already there, so it's very less preferable, and this sounds like a good bargain. It's a slightly long route. In fact, it's quite a long route. It's longer than both these. The good thing is that the density is low and the traffic lights are low. And because the traffic lights are low, that I know that I can save those extra 30 seconds or extra 50 seconds that an extra traffic lights gives me. So I will say this is the selected route. And this is a small graphical representation of problem 3, which said making short-term plans in terms of long-term plans. Now, here I have shown the entire road network graph starting from this source that happened within a radius of what I call as max historical. I said that the maximum that I'll plan is max historical, after which the traffic dynamics would be uncertain. There's no use of planning. The metrics by which I'm planning will be uncertain, which is a traffic density or which is a traffic dynamics. After max historical, it'll become way too computationally expensive to compute the path. So I'll plan only till max historic. And that's what I've done. I've shown the road network graph till a total cost of max historical. And the total cost, of course, is the cost from the source. So let's say I take this node, it's cost from the source and a heuristic cost to the node, which is simply my distance upon speed, the expected travel time. So at a distance of max historical, I select the route which is here, which has the least total cost. The least total cost means least traffic density, least expected travel time, least number of traffic lights. I select this route which has the least total cost. Now, I am assuming that it would be possible to reach the goal from this point. There is no guarantee. I am committed to this route even though there is no guarantee, and that's what I said, that the initial simulations where I was trying, where I was actually going in for this guarantee, they said that a route was always possible. And hence, without a guarantee, I would be committed to this route. Now, what would happen is that this is the route selected out here. As soon as I reach this point, or as soon as I reach the next intersection, I will replan here. And again, there's a new road, there's a same road network graph, except for it starts at a later stage, or it starts at this here. And that means I'll go at a little more, at a higher stage, so that this is max historical, what we have here as max historical. And again, I select the best route, and it can be seen that the route got changed. So some new vehicles would have come in, some vehicles would have changed their path, or some traffic density would have changed. Now this is the best path. I'll come here, I'll again replan, I'll again expand the tree up to max historical, I'll again select in some new route when I plan, when I come out over here. So as I go nearer and nearer to, so what I'm basically doing, I'm replanning at every intersection, and replanning at every intersection, I'm going nearer and nearer to the goal until I reach out this point where clearly it can be seen, if I expand till max historical, my goal is actually found. So my goal is found, I'll end my search, I'll use this best path, I'll come here, I'll replan, I'll again find the path like this, that ends at the goal. So I'll still replan at every intersection, but now my search is ending at the goal, and I'll keep on doing this until I actually reach the goal. So this is what is the problem number two, or problem number three, making short-term plans. Short-term plans enable me to make the algorithm computationally efficient, or to make it possible to replan at every crossing, or to make it possible to come up with a plan even though the actual load architecture is too complex, there are too many loads. And that is all the algorithm that we have. We'll be comparing it with some basic approaches. There will be some static approaches, which means I'll plan from source to goal a route and I'll stick to it. I'll never change it. And there are dynamic approaches, which means I'll replan at every crossing. In my static obstacle, since the first approach, it only minimizes the expected traffic, expected time to reach goal. So it's basically total distance upon total speed. It minimizes the distance upon speed, which gives me my expected time to reach the goal. So that's summation over all the loads that we'll take. Pessimistic, again, it's distance upon speed, but it attempts to select roads with more number of lanes. So a road with higher, so it will multiply a weight, where the weight will be inversely proportional to the number of lanes. More number of lanes means it will be a more preferred route. Less number of lanes means it will be a less preferred route. Traffic messaging channel means that I simply observe between every pair of intersection how long vehicles are taking. How long vehicles are taking from going from one road to the other road, or in traveling from one intersection to the other intersection, or in traveling between traveling a road. I simply observe how much time the vehicles are taking. I note this time, and I simply use it as an indication of the time that the vehicle will take out at this road. Now I need to adapt it a little bit to work with diverse speed vehicles, because this general concept is for vehicles which travel at the same speeds. A little adaptation is arrived, and then this method is used for comparison. Corresponding to this, we have TMC dynamic. My actual approach was trying to find roads with least traffic density with the least traffic lights. So this method, it finds only traffic with least traffic density. TMC with traffic lights is TMC method. So I use the information, the recorded information, how much time does it take for a vehicle to travel from in a road or from one intersection to the other, and I simply add a time corresponding to how much time it takes, how much time it waits for the traffic lights, or in how much time it's waiting for the red traffic signal to turn green. So basically this will have two parts. The expected path to travel at a road R plus the expected travel time to wait at the next intersection T. And when this submitted over the all the roads R, it gives me my cost metric. So these are the methods that we have, and we would be experimenting out with these methods, and it can be clearly seen that the proposed approach performed best. Now this is what is my actual metric of study, which is the time to complete the journey for the average time to complete journey. My proposed method clearly performs best out of all the other approaches. Now I'm not explaining what is given in the text, how the other approaches compare with each other, were the trends expected or not. A thing that you'll have to see is that in general, if we increase the number of vehicles, the time increases. Here what happens is that every scenario here is random in nature. So it's a fresh pair of source, it's a fresh pair of goals. And because it's random, sometimes the sources and the goal happen to get close to each other. Sometimes they happen to get away from each other. Sometimes they happens to be more slow-moving vehicles. Sometimes slow-moving vehicles get generated at the dirtiest of places. So although the same general trend is there, which is somewhere here, because every of our instance, it's random. Therefore, it's not clearly visible. And that is what I do when I compare the... Another thing that I can compare is the travel distance. That was time, this is distance. And again, the vehicle is traveling... the proposed approach is making the vehicles travel at lesser distances, which is an indicator of why the times are less. And the speed is simply the distance upon time. A higher speed means less congestion happens. And that's what you see, that mostly it's associated with higher speeds. And I said that the single lane overtakes are very important for the algorithm working, and that's what we see out here, that with single lane overtaking it takes a lot lesser time, and hence the efficiency is much better. We clearly should not be following a very slow moving vehicle ahead when the road is sparsely populated. When it's densely populated, of course, it's more or less a congestion scenario where the general traffic anyhow would be very slow. But in when the road is not densely populated, we need some method to overtake slow moving vehicles. And that will be all for the presentation. Thank you.